A reading from the book of Psalms, chapter 1, verses 1 to 6. Psalms, chapter 1, verses 1 to 6. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bring forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Here ends the reading.
Verse 6. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. The caption for this morning meditation is Blessings of the Blessed. Verse 6 presents a key to understanding this song. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. So in this song, the way of the righteous and the way of the ungodly are contradicted. The way of the righteous and the way of the ungodly. The way of the righteous lead the righteous to prosperity. The righteous prospers. The way of the ungodly leads the ungodly to perishing. The ungodly perishes. Just we have a reading of verses 4 and 5. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. The ungodly perish. But the way of the righteous, God knows the way of the righteous. There are abundant blessings for the righteous. When I was reading this passage, in the way of the righteous, I was able to see, which many of us would have noticed, in the way of the righteous will not do three things and will do two things. In verse 1 we see what the three things what the righteous will not do. In verse 2 we see two things what the righteous will do. Then in verse 3 we see a fourfold blessing for the righteous. Verses 4 and 5 tell us that the way of the unrighteous will lead him, or the way of the ungodly will lead him to perishing. Verse 6, the Lord finishes with a keynote. The way of the righteous is contradicted the way of the ungodly. We go to verse 1 to see three things the righteous will not do. That's the way of righteous, the way of the righteous. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Many a time, the familiarity breeds contempt. Because we are familiar with this psalm, because we are familiar with this, Psalm 1 I know very well. This familiarity will breed contempt. I also don't want to brag that I'm going to tell you something what you don't know. Maybe I'm just bringing back to your attention what you know. It starts with a beautiful phrase, blessed is the man. It doesn't say blessed is the king. He doesn't say blessed is the philosopher. He doesn't say blessed is the rich man. He doesn't say blessed is the scholar. He doesn't say blessed is the successful. Blessed is the man or the woman, an ordinary person, whosoever it may be, rich or poor, king or slave, anybody, free or bond, anybody, man or woman, blessed is he. That word blessed means enviably happy. Somebody who enjoys, that word is, word speaks about plurality. Somebody who enjoys a lot of blessings. The Tamil equivalent is not Aasirvadikapattavan. The Tamil equivalent could be probably Bhakyavan, Bhakyam Bettavan. A man who enjoys a lot of blessings. Blessed is that man. Is he talking about a scholar? Nay. Is he talking about a king? Nay. Is he talking about a rich, prosperous businessman? Nay. Is he talking about a philosopher? Nay. A scientist? Nay. Who is this blessed man? A politician? Nay. In the sight of God, this enviably happy, just anybody it can be. And there are five qualities of him. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. He walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Outward walk is a reflection of inward grace. Outward walk is the reflection of the inward grace. In many situations, we need counsel. And inwardly we take a decision. Because we have taken that decision, we walk in that direction. Let me repeat it. Because we take a decision inwardly, we walk in that direction. We take a lot of counsel. Say for example, if it's a marriage, how to have the marriage, where to buy the dress, what type of a dress we should buy. And we take a lot of counsel. What should be the talk? What should be this? What should be that? How should be the decoration? I want to buy a thing. I want to have this program. Carmel first. I need a lot of counsel. How could we have it? If there is a problem, if there's a police case, or if there's a husband and wife problem, if a daughter is going through a problem, you need some decision to be taken. So in every situation, we take counsel. We take counsel. We need other suggestions. My dear brother, my dear sister, the way of the righteous, he doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. It means the decision of the righteous will not be based on the counsel of the ungodly. He walks because he decides. He chooses that way. He chooses this direction. So that walk speaks about his action. That action, he takes that step. He takes that step because somebody has put that idea in him. You have to do like this. You have to do like that. You don't worry about what pastor says. You don't worry about what the Bible says. We have to do like this. For every turn of life, we take counsels. But how do we understand it? The way of the righteous or the way of the ungodly is how you choose your decisions. Maybe there is a problem between the husband and wife. Your daughter and you were in your daughter's life or in your son's life. Your daughter and son talk to you about it. What's the counsel you give? Or you go and talk to somebody, this is the problem my daughter faces. What type of a counsel you get? Your counsel The counsel you take into your heart decides your step, and your steps decides your destination. Your destination decides whether you are taking right steps or wrong steps. My dear brother, my dear sister, so I love to tell you three things. Number one, discerning the ungodly person. I got a problem. Now who is counseling me? Who is counseling me? Who is telling me, do this, don't do that, buy this, don't buy that, you go to your court, or go to your police station, or you hit that person, don't hit that person, speak to him, don't speak to him. Who tells me that? To whom I am going? Is he a godly man, or is he a politician? Is he ungodly or spiritual? My dear brother, my dear sister, many times we take decisions based on the counsel we get ungodly persons. He may be a lawyer, he may be a friend, he may be a very powerful person, and we believe that person could help us. And that, why do we take that counsel? That counsel seems to be good. Good. He will tell you, yes, yes, you give a complaint to the police. Or he will tell you, we'll go to a lawyer, we'll send a notice. He will tell you, we'll take two or three gundas, we'll go and threaten him. That's the right lesson we can teach him. Just sitting in prayer is not going to help. If you say, maile, maile, eragupodu, will that mile throw that feather? We have to go and pluck it, man. God helps only those who help themselves. I don't know from which scripture they get it. They get it. Act! Chumma chavan chavan chavan. Chavamani chavamani thai vula ketta. We are in the world. We must be worldly wise. Who is telling you? Who is that friend? Who is that uncle? Who is that mother? So first discern that person. Is he godly? Is he spiritual? Is he a man of God? Who is he? So the righteous will discern that person from where the counsel comes. You walk because you take that counsel. Because you accept that counsel, you agree with that counsel, it seems good to you. I'm not blaming one who counsels you, but you agree with that counsel. Every step we take because we agree with that counsel. Though we don't concur with that. Somehow we believe, okay, that's the right decision. So the problem, the righteous will not take a decision based on the counsel of the ungodly. And number two, discern the counsel itself. It can, in English it's very clear, he walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. The counsel of the ungodly. It is not only the counsel of an ungodly person, it's a very deep one. When I was meditating yesterday, you have to decide whether the counsel is godly or not. That alosana, adhu deva bhakti kuriyada, avabhakti kuriyada. The counsel may come from your pastor. The counsel may come from one of the believers in the church. That person may be godly. That person may be godly. But I don't know whether the counsel is godly. In our church, there is an ungodly counsel from a godly person, a believer. A sister became pregnant. A sister became pregnant. It was very difficult to manage with one more child in that family. He said, we encourage, we'll pray. We'll pray. And one of the believers who helps out in the ministry went and said, ஊழியக்காரங்களுக்கு என்ன தெரியும், நீ அபார்ட் பண்ணிடு, கில் த சைல்ட். டீச்சிங் எ பிலீவர் டு அபார்ட் த ஃபீட்டஸ், எ ஃபுல் க்ரோன் ஃபீட்டஸ், இட்ஸ் எ கோல்ட் பிளட் மர்டர். டுடே தட் சைல்ட் இஸ் எ கிரேட் பிளெஸ்ஸிங் டு தட் ஃபேமிலி. It's a great blessing to that family. Who gave that counsel to abort the child? A believer. A believer who helps in the ministry. So the counsel is from a believer, but the counsel itself is ungodly. How do we know that? That person came and said, so and so is asking me to kill the child. And added a word, ஊழியக்காரங்களுக்கு என்ன தெரியும். So what are the type of people helping us? That's also another great grace. ஊழியக்காரங்களுக்கு என்ன தெரியும். My dear brother, my dear sister, it is not just the counsel. It's not from whom the counsel comes. Number one, you decide the person whether he is godly or not. Number two, is very, very important. You decide whether the counsel is godly or not. The counsel is godly or not. My dear brother, my dear sister, there was an anxious moment. The doctors advised the child has to be aborted. The parents came to us. We said, we would pray, we would pray, we prayed. The Lord has blessed them. They are now brought a child. It's become a blessing to that family. So many examples. I'm not talking about abortion, but the counsel. Whether the counsel is godly or ungodly. The counsel is godly or ungodly. Many a time. In English we say that time the malady is, the remedy is worse than the malady. The remedy is worse than a malady. There was a family in a, there was a girl in a dilemma whether she could wear jewels or should not wear jewels. In a dilemma whether we can wear jewels or should not wear jewels. When the child was in a dilemma, a believer is counseling the child. Now you can give two different types of counsel. My dear brother, my dear tambi, we can give different types of counsel. We can tell them what the Bible says. And many a time, we fail there. When a child was in a dilemma, a senior sister took the child to the jewelry shop to buy the jewels for the child. The child is unable to take a decision this way or that way. Till we would be able to help that child. Till we would be able to help that child. Many a time, ungodly counsel or suggestions would come from godly people. Godly people. If we are godly, 100% we stand on the word of God. With love and affection, we talk to them word of God. When they are weak in faith, we love them, we help them. But we will not allow them, we will not be counseling them to take a different decisions. We will not be a part with them. It can be in our family, it can be for our children, our grandchildren. But what is our counsel? So the problem is, number one, we don't discern from where, from whom we get the counsel. Number two, we don't discern the counsel itself. It's a very deep topic. Familiarity breeds contempt, Shakespeare said. Because we are familiar with some Bible passage, we don't understand the depth of it. Many a time the remedy has become worse than the maladies. The remedy has become worse than the maladies. We become bad counselors. We help people take wrong decisions. We help people take decisions against the word of God. Against the word of God. We all make mistakes. From my personal life, I very briefly tell you. When we were in AC, we needed a place of worship. Excruciating situation. And we were to vacate the place where we were. Pastor was crying. And he was praying for a fixed place. When others suggested alternatives, he was very furious at them. One morning he had a special prayer for the place of worship. How the council would become ungodly. Please listen. You should not allow the devil to talk through you. I should not allow the devil to talk through me. We are getting ready for the prayer. As I was coming, before I could come out of the house, one broker came. He said that near the tank there is a litigation place. So ask your pastor to take that place for lease. At least for the next 30 years there will be no problem. By the time you can either buy that land or you can think about another plot. I said, no, our pastor is not for alternatives. So I went for the prayer. Pastor was crying, sobbing. He was using a word in Tamil. Meen kudukkira devan kuda kudukka mattara. He was crying. That time one word he used. At least oru temporary edatha kaata mattara. Sir, God given revelation. Just now somebody told me there is a temporary place available. Pastor is saying, will not God show a temporary place? The prayer was over. This is the spiritual. Please listen. The prayer was over. I just dashed into his room. The praise Lord, Pastor. Praise Lord. He was very sad. I said, this morning when broker came, said such and such thing. He got furious, very angry. With a stern face, he looked at me and said, "Enna kadaisila broker pinnala po solreera." Pastor, you only told us about an alternate place. He kept quiet for some time. He said in Tamil, "Ambi, ni room ku varumba enna nenachanna, Pastor." ஆல்டர்னேட் இடம்லாம் வேண்டாம். கர்த்தர் காண்பித்த இடத்துக்காக ஜோம் பண்ணுவோம். ஆல்டர்னேட் இடம்லாம் வேண்டாம் அப்படின்னு நீங்க சொல்லுவீங்கன்னு நினைச்சேன். நீங்களே வந்து ஆல்டர்னேட் இடம் சொல்றீங்களே, என் ஹார்ட் உடஞ்சிடுச்சு. சாரி பாஸ்டர், ஐ மூவ்டு. சாரி பாஸ்டர். தம்பி, நீங்க தான் ரெண்டு வாரத்துக்கு முன்னால பேசுனீங்க. When God has fixed Sarah, don't choose Hagar. கர்த்தர் சாராளை நியமித்திருக்கும் போது ஆகாரை தெரிந்து கொள்ளாதன்னு நீங்க தான் பேசுனீங்க. நீங்க வந்து என்கிட்ட சொல்லுவீங்க, When God has chosen a place, don't choose an alternative. நீங்களே வந்து புரோக்கரை சொல்றீங்களா? Who said? Robert Simon, anointed. But what was that counsel? That's not godly. You may be a godly person. Peter said, an apostle, chosen vessel said, you need not go to the cross. That's not Peter, that was a Satan. When you give an ungodly counsel, it's not you. Satan is speaking through you. So number one, discern the person who is giving you counsel. Number two, discern the counsel. If you are righteous, you will not take a decision based on An ungodly counsel, whether the counsel is from an ungodly person, whether or the counsel itself is ungodly. Number three, he will act only on godly counsel. What is that godly counsel? We read in Psalm 119 verse 24, Psalm 119 verse 24, thy testimonies also are my delight and my counselors. God's testimonies. What God can do, what's in the word of God, what has God has done for others is no secret. What God has done for others, he will do for me. He will do for me. His testimonies are my counsels. So my decision will be based on what the Bible says, what God can do, what God has done in others' life, what God can do in my life, in the child, what's God's will, what's God's pleasure. It's not what others say, what the Bible says. What the Bible says. The son comes and cries, oh, my wife is not cooking. My wife is not giving food. My wife is always going to her mother's place. My wife is not taking care of me. Okay, son, divorce her. File a case. I'll choose another person. No. That father will tell the child, son, unless for fornication, adultery, you should not separate, set apart your wife. You should not separate your wife. You should not divorce your wife. We'll pray, son. A godly counsel. Bible-based counsel. Bible-based counsel. That may not go well with the world. My dear brother, my dear sister, concerning time, I go move on to the second one. So the way of the righteous, his decisions will not be based on, number one, the counsel of the ungodly person. Number two, even if it's from a godly person, if it is not godly, his decisions will not be based on it. Number three, God's testimonies will be his counselors. Number two, blessed is the man that standeth not in the way of sinners. Somebody who has given step by step deterioration. Somebody who has given ear to an ungodly counsel. Somebody who has taken a decision. Somebody who acts upon an ungodly counsel will find himself taking up a position of a sinner. Earlier it was only an ungodly person. He gave a counsel. Because he started acting upon the counsel of the ungodly person, because he started acting upon an ungodly person, today you are standing in the place of a sinner. There was a family dispute. I was suggesting what you could do for peace, what the Bible says, how we could accept our laws. When I was giving that suggestion, suppose if the family doesn't want to take it up, where will they find themselves? They find themselves in a situation what a sinner will do. They have to do. They are compelled to do. They are constrained to do what an ordinary person, a sinner will do. You want to get a job. Somebody will give a counsel. You go and meet that person. He will help you. Surely he will help you. I'll talk to him. You go and meet that person. So instead, it's not a counsel from God or a prophet. If the prophet says go and see so and so, or the Bible gives a direction, it's a different thing from an ungodly person. Now you have taken a decision. You're going to that person. Now you have to bribe. You have to bribe. You took the counsel of the ungodly. You are standing in the place of a sinner. You are standing in the place of a sinner. You give bribe. He takes bribe. You are sinning. You are helping that person to sin. to get a blessing, maybe to get a job, to get a promotion. You are a sinner. You are paying bribes according to the law of the land. You can be put in prison. One who gives, one who receives. So because you gave ear to the ungodly person, you are standing in the way of a sinner. You are taking up a position of a sinner. So the first evil begets the second evil. Because you thought that counsel was good, and you have chosen that, you have decided that action, and when you want to do that action, you are finding yourself standing in the situation of a sinner. You are doing what a sinner will do. You are doing what a sinner will do. They ultimately want to get some success. But there is a way of the godly, there is a way of the ungodly. The way of the godly may not seem to be very prosperous. The way of the ungodly may seem to be very sure. When you pray, you are not sure whether you will get the job or not. But you are sure if you can grease that palm of that minister, you will get the job. You are sure. That ungodly man who gave the counsel has given that confidence. Your confidence level is very high. More than believing in God. Now what we do, we pray and go. We want God to help us in giving bribe. We pray that God should help us that the bribe money should not go waste. If somebody would come and ask me, Pastor, I'm going to give bribe for this job. You pray that it should come. What do you want me to pray? If I am sincere, I should pray that they should not sin. They should not sin. Can you see that? So when we yield ungodly counsel, naturally, logically, rationally, we stand in the place of a sinner. We do what a sinner will do. So here we say, the way of the righteous, he will not stand in the way of a sinner. There is a way for a sinner. That's how he will do. That's how he deals the problems. That's how he deals false accusations. In a property case, that's how he will behave. In a marital affair, that's how the ungodly person will behave. My dear brother, my dear sister, when I was meditating, just I want to tell you three things in this also. So you are taking a position or a stand to do evil things. The counsel was given, you go and meet that minister. Now you are standing in a position not just to meet him, but to bribe him. To bribe him. To do an evil thing. Three things. You have chosen a much trodden path. Why have you chosen this situation? This is much trodden path. Many people have done this. Many of your relatives have done this. Many of your friends have done this. Many of your classmates have done this. Many of your believers have done this. Many servants of God have done this. Many people have walked in this way. As a counselor will say, see, I got this for many people. Many have done this. You are able to choose that path because it seemed a sure path. Just waiting in the Lord for prayer, you are not certain. You are not certain. But the counselor has made it very strong. It's a very sure path. I don't know why I say this. All through yesterday, when said Psalm 1, I thought, Lord, everybody knows it by heart. The same phrase, familiarity breeds contempt. Because you know it very well, you don't know the depth of it. Number one, you have chosen this wrong path because it's a sure path. Many have trodden through this path. That word path here, it's because somebody has walked before you, that path is formed. That way is formed. Many ungodly people have walked in that way. Are many godly people, because of ungodly counsel, they have walked in that way. So you are choosing that way. You are choosing that way. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's a very big mistake in your life you do, because it's a much trodden path. Number two, it is broad, wide and easy. It's very broad. It's very wide. It's very easy. Matthew 7:13, enter ye in at the gate, the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth into destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Many have chosen that path. And number three, choosing God's way. When yielded to God's counsel, you are taking a position of God's way. It may be very narrow, it may be very straight, but this is the path saints have chosen. Psalm 16 verse 11, thou wilt show me the path of life. God will show me path of life. That counselor has shown me path of destruction. That's the way of sinners. A child of God, I cannot do it. I should not do it. A servant of God should not do it. In Psalm 16 verse 11, you will show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. To say it, I may go quickly to number three. Blessed is the man that sitteth not in the seat of the scornful. Number one, some counsel is coming. You take a decision. You begin to act on it. Because of that, you find yourself standing in a situation, placed in a situation, what a sinner, a not born again person, not a Christian, an unchristian thing. You find yourself doing an unchristian thing, and you continue in that. You yourself, I tell you honestly, after some time, you yourself find sitting in the seat of scorn. You yourself, first you take a decision to act on the ungodly, you are finding yourself in the situation of a sinner, and when you sin, you will sit, or you will take up a position, not of the scornful, you will become a scoffer. You are in the seat of where a scoffer, a scornful, a mocker should sit. He will sit. Amanga summa kadavul 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 nambi enatha kanna. Pastor solluvar edho koyilukku pettuvar. Pala naanga mundiya mari illanga. Okay, it's better than other places. This pastor is okay. Summa kadavul kadavul na enna mandirathile maanga kaikkum. You will become a scorner. You will mock at God's values. Ubhasala and the brojanella. Or Ashasa Bhas and the German yet. Sumanga. A coil ponama and the mantra. When you yield to the counsel of the ungodly, when you find yourself in the place of a sinner, slowly, steadily, you will find yourself in the seat of the scorners. The mockers. My dear brother, my dear sister, one who acts on bad counsel will take a stand. Last night I just put this writing. One who acts on bad counsel will take a stand on doing evil things and subsequently mock at divine values. ப்ரே பண்ணு, ப்ரே பண்ணு, ப்ரே பண்ணு. அதெல்லாம் நாங்கள் பண்ணாத ப்ரேயராக நீ பண்ணிட போகிற, பண்ணு பண்ணு. இதெல்லாம் புதுசில் அப்படித்தான். யூ வில் மார்க் அ டிவைன் வேல்யூஸ். ஸோ வாட் ஆர் த சிம்டம்ஸ் கிரிட்டிசைசிங் அண்ட் பிளேமிங் காட்? சப்போஸ் இஃப் யூ ஃபைண்ட் யுவர் செல்ஃப், கடவுள் நம்பி என்னத்தை கண்டேன், ஏன் எனக்கு இந்த சோதனை, ஐ எம் நாட் கெட்டிங் எனி திங், ஐ மஸ்ட் சீ டு மை வே, ஐ மஸ்ட் டேக் மை ஸ்டாண்ட். ஏ, தட்ஸ் ரைட், காட்லினஸ் இஸ் தேர், ஐ மஸ்ட் பி வைஸ். இஃப் யூ பிகின் டு டாக் லைக் திஸ், ஆர் யூ ஆர் டாக்கிங் லைக் திஸ், வெதர் யூ ஆர் ஹியர், ஆர் யூ ஆர் வாட்சிங் மீ அட் தி லைவ் ஸ்ட்ரீமிங், ஆர் யூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு லிசன் டு திஸ் லேட்டர், ஐ டெல் யூ, யூ ஆர் ஆல்ரெடி இன் த சீட் ஆஃப் த மார்க்கர்ஸ். You are criticizing divine values. You are criticizing humility. You are criticizing peace. You are criticizing God's will. You are criticizing God's plan for you. You are questioning divine power. You are questioning the attributes of God. God doesn't see this. God is not helping me. God is not looking at me. You have become a mocker. You become a mocker. And number two, you are mocking at the faithful. Not only are you mocking at God, you are mocking at your wife, you are mocking at your husband, you are mocking at your friends. Oh, what is the use of this? Divine values. What is the use of removing jewels? What's the use of making this dedication? What's the use of being holy? All these are humbug. Only outward. Because now you are sitting on the seat of the mockers. You are questioning, you are criticizing. You are speaking bad about, you are speaking ill of the value systems. How all these things happen? Yielded to the counsel of the ungodly that led you to take a stand of the sinners, now you are sitting on the seat of the scornful. My dear, the righteous will not do it. The position of the believer takes, in Joshua 24:16 he says, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served, that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Whether God blesses or not, that's what we read in Daniel chapter 3 verses 16, 17 and 18. Nebuchadnezzar, make sure there's one thing. God we serve is able to deliver us. He is able to deliver us. Whether he delivers us or not, we will not worship these gods. We will not worship these gods. My dear brother, my dear sister, a senior pastor waiting for a long time for the marriage of their daughter, standing very firm on the jewels issue. Marriage was getting delayed. A very good offer came, again from a ministry family. Everything suited well. Only one thing, jewelry. This senior pastor went to the key leaders of the Pentecostalic church in Chennai. Went to the key leaders of the Pentecostalic church in Chennai. Pastor, like this, an offer has come. But we were not wearing jewels. The pastors who are not wearing jewels, godly people, gave an ungodly counsel. There's nothing wrong in it. Kachitamana prambathikla. God will do it. We just yield to it. Finally he decided, okay, there's nothing wrong in it. This pastor, agreed to give his daughter in marriage without jewels, because that girl was praying. This senior pastor went for a conference. A pastor from Kanyakumari preached in that conference. That pastor didn't know anything about the problem of this senior pastor. That pastor spoke about the truth. When the meeting was over, this pastor with tears, he took a decision. God saved me. God saved me. Whether marriage is for my daughter or marriage is no for my daughter, I will not change. That is the path of a righteous. Yes or no, I will stand for. Well, the king says you pray or you don't pray. What the king says, don't give the window and open and pray. I'll be convenient. I'll close the window and pray. No, this is what I do. I want to look at Jerusalem and pray. There's an Old Testament saints. I'll do according to my custom. I'm not doing anything against the king. My Lord is my king. If they want to arrest me, arrest me. If they want to put me in the jail, put me in the jail. If they want me to throw to the den of lions, let me throw to the den of lions. My conscience is clear. I am not doing anything against the king. I am praying to my God. Whether he delivers or he doesn't deliver. The way of the righteous. He will never mock at the value systems. My dear brother, my dear sister. So the righteous, he will not take the counsel of the ungodly. As I said, the key leaders of Chennai, Pentecostal leaders, those who are not wearing jewels, they gave an ungodly counsel. They are godly. They gave an ungodly counsel. The righteous will not walk in the way of the counsel of the ungodly. And he will not take a position of the sinner because he is not walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Because he is not taking the position of the sinner, he is not sinning. Because he is not sinning, he is not going to mock at the value system of God. He is not going to mock at faith. He is not going to mock at holiness. He is not going to mock at sanctification. He is not going to mock at what the saints believe. He is not mock at what the Bible says. He is not mock at what God says. He is not going to mock at prayer. He is not going to mock at fasting. What will he do? Again, I say two things and conclude. But the delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Number one. And number four. Blessed is the man whose delight is in the law of the Lord. The law of the Lord appears 21 times in the Bible and 3 times in the Psalms of God, Psalms of David. And here in chapter 1, and it again appears in chapter 19, and again it appears in chapter 119. So, to have delight in the law of the Lord, number one, understand the law of the Lord. Understand the law of the Lord. Law means not do's and don'ts. Law means literally a principle that binds a system, that binds a person, that binds a society, that binds a community, that binds a nation. A law is a system that binds. We say the law of center of gravity. I throw this hanky up. It goes up and up because of the force I exerted on it. When the force exhausted, because of the gravitational force, it comes back. It's a law that binds, that acts on this small piece of cloth. It's a law. The spiritual, that's a physical laws, biological laws, natural laws, chemical law, chemistry, laws in chemistry, laws in mathematics. That's the laws in the spiritual world. Laws of the Lord. Try to understand what are the laws of the Lord. In Psalm 19 verse 7, the Bible says, the law of the Lord is perfect for every situation, for marriage, for divorce, for dressing, for loving somebody, to think about a career or business, our future. The law of the Lord is perfect. Number one, try to understand the law of the Lord. Number two, find out what makes you happy, whether the law of the Lord or the law of the world, the counsel of friends, the counsel of relatives, the counsel of mother, the counsel of some godly people, ungodly counsel. What makes you happy? When you take a decision, what makes you happy? The Lord has chosen a girl for you, for your son. It doesn't fit any of the parameter you have got. It doesn't fit in any of the parameter you have got. When you think about the beauty, when you think about the color, somebody said A to Z. Age, beauty, cost, dowry, fairness, education, goodness, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, height, you can go up to Z. None of these things fit in. But you know God has shown this. Where is your delight? Are you sad about what God has chosen for you? A young man said, I want to have a girl according to God's choice. And under yada godama kudutra kodata. So he made a wonderful choice. Today he is scared even to go to his house. My dear brother, my dear sister, what is your joy? It's all God's decision. God's decision. When I made a choice, I have seen the girl. I don't know her height, I don't know her beauty, I don't know her talents, I don't know her nature. We never had datings, we don't know each other. I never even seen her face. My dear brother, my dear sister, till this day I know that we are made for each other. God's choice. God's choice. Not to speak about myself. Where is your delight? Delight is when all my parameters are met with, or delight is when I know it is God's choice. My dear brother, my dear sister, number three, easy to do things which are our delight. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. When your delight is in the law of the Lord, it's very easy for you to walk in the law of the Lord. When you walk in the law of the Lord, you take a position of a saint. When you take a position of a saint, you will take your seat with the godly. You'll take your position, your seat of a servant of God, of a child of God. Because your counsel is the law of the Lord, your decisions are based on the law of the Lord, your delight is in the law of the Lord, you have understood the law of the Lord, you are applying the law of the Lord in your life, so you are in a position of a saint and you are sitting with servants of God. So number one, in the way of the righteous, he will not take the counsel of the ungodly. In the way of the righteous, he will not stand himself in a position of a sinner. He will not do what a sinner will do. He is a child of God. And he will not be mocking it, questioning it, demeaning it, God's value systems. He will have his delight in the law of the Lord. Because his delight is in the law of the Lord, very easily he will walk in that law and he will find himself in the position of a saint. And the fifth one, and in the law that he meditate day and night. Blessed is the man that meditates day and night in God's law. What is literally this meditation? Christian meditation is not emptying the mind, the yoga and the other transcendental meditation. You have to empty your mind. You have to empty your mind. Anytime evil spirits can occupy that empty space, very dangerous. Christian meditation is not emptying the mind. Christian meditation is filling the mind, filling the mind, filling the mind with the love of God, with the name of God, with the attributes of God, with the characteristics of God. Meditating on God. Meditating what God can do for me. What is the power of God? What is the nature of God? Who this God is? Then sings my soul. How great the Lord! So the Christian meditation is filling your mind with the love of God, with the name of God. And the Christian meditation is not reading scriptures, but chewing the word of God. Last night I was just making these notes. Christian meditation is chewing the word of God, not just reading the word of God. Meditate on the word of God. Ask about him. Sit and think how great he is. All things are possible with him to them that believe. He knows to do good thing to me. When I am being evil, I know to give good things to my children. How much more my heavenly Father will know to give good things to our children? How much he will take care of? Who will take care of my children after me? My dear brother, my dear sister, again from our life I tell you. In the prime of the youth, in her early college days, sister lost her father. Shortly lost her mother. Young brother, a brother and sister in their youth left alone. With all glory to God. Did God leave them forsaken? Today God is using both of them powerfully in the ministry. God has blessed them with all blessings. Blessings on the earth, blessings in heaven. No father, no mother. No, wrong. God was their father. God is their father. God is their mother. I am mightily privileged. For me, father-in-law is God. Father is God. My dear brother, my dear sister. Meditate on the word of God. Chew the word of God. I love to read what Spurgeon has read. I'm just reading verbatim. It is not only reading that does us good. It's not only reading that God does us good, Spurgeon says. But the soul inwardly feeding on it and digesting it. The soul inwardly feeding on it. And it's getting a part of our system. Tanmayamadal, digesting it. That does good to us. Not just mere reading. Spurgeon says, a preacher once told me that he had read the Bible through 20 times on his knees. Reading the Bible on knees may be a good exercise. Our missionary Anupandraj used to say many times, I read the Bible on my knees. It may be a good exercise. But this is not exactly what the Bible says. Here, Spurgeon speaks about a preacher. A preacher once told me that he had read the Bible through 20 times on his knees and had never found the doctrine of election there. God has chosen us. Devanudaiya therindhukolludhal. He said he has never seen the doctrine of election there. Very likely not. Very likely that he could not find out when he was reading it on his knees. It is a most uncomfortable position in which to read. With all respect to Anupandraj, I'm just reading to you what Spurgeon says. Spurgeon says, it is the most uncomfortable position in which to read. I also read the Bible at times on my knees. But it's not just reading the Bible on our knees. It's a very uncomfortable position. He says, if he had sat in an easy chair after reading the Bible, if he had sat in an easy chair, he would have been better able to understand it. He would have been better able to understand it, whether on the chair or easy chair or knees, whatever your comfortable position, squatting or whatever it may be. Just chew it. Day and night. good time, bad time, chew the word of God. And number three, that meditation literally speaks. Mutter it. Speak about it. Tell your wife, don't worry, ma, God will not forsake us. Tell your husband, surely God will open up a way. Don't worry, ma. Fill your mouth with goodness. Fill your mouth with words of God. That meditate literally means mutter. So five things we saw very quickly I go through. Number one, he will not walk in the way of act according the counsel of ungodly. He will not find himself in the position of a sinner. He will not be mocking at a question at the God's divine value system. He will have delight, happiness in the word of God, and he will meditate on it. He will fill his mind with that. He will chew that. He will mutter that. And for him, there are blessings of the righteous. There are five blessings of the righteous. I don't have time to speak on those five things. Just I read verse 3, or rather four things. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth its fruit in its season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Number one, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Prosperity, all your needs will be met with. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth its fruit in its season. He will be fruit bearing. Number three, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth its fruit in its season. Its leaf also shall not wither. Your testimony. The leaf speaks about your testimony. Your testimony will never wither. Your testimony will never wither. A few days back, I was preaching in a small congregation Friday evening. In that congregation, I said, in 72 September, I received Jesus Christ. 44 years have rolled by. He's always good unto me. My leaf has never withered. If your way is the way of the righteous, your leaf will never wither. And the last one, whatsoever you do, it will prosper. Shall we just stand to our feet? Take a solemn decision. Either we'll walk in the way of the righteous, or walk in the way of the ungodly. That speaks about your behavior, your actions, the way of the righteous, the way of the ungodly. Blessed is the man who walks in the way of the righteous. Destruction is for the man that walks in the way of the ungodly. He'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that brings its fruit in its season, and your leaf will not wither, and whatsoever you do, it will prosper. Whatsoever you do, it will prosper. You shall see God's blessings in your life. Today, take a decision. My next step, based on the law of the Lord. My delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law, I'll meditate day and night. I'll chew upon that. I'll fill my mind with that. That will be the light unto my path. The next step, God will order. Whether he delivers or he doesn't deliver. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. We'll serve the Lord. Dear Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, Lord. I commit myself, O Master God. I take a decision. Now honor it, please honor it, O Lord. Give me the grace. Every step, every turn, let it be your law. Let it be your principle. Let that be the path of the righteous. Purishanadhyanama. The Lord says, I hear His voice. He tells His people, walk in My way. Follow Me. Follow My footsteps. My footsteps will lead you to heaven. When you turn to the left or to the right, the ears will hear, this is the way, walk herein. You'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. A tree that can bring its fruit in its season. Your leaf will not wither. Whatever you do, it will prosper. I will make that prosper, says the Lord God of Israel. Your loving Jesus is going before you. Let come what me. What others do. You want to serve the Lord of your fathers, which they serve the other side of the flood. You serve. You want to serve the Lord of Amorites, the land in which you dwell. You serve. Rest for me in My house. We serve the Lord God of Israel who made heaven and the earth. Whether He delivers me or not, He is able to deliver me. I will not serve other gods. Thus the Lord says, His grace is upon you. He will not leave you, He will not forsake you. There will be no unrighteous in Him. Dear Father God, we thank You, we praise You, we worship You for this morning, O Lord. Bless Your people with Your anointing. Today let them choose in their life the way of the righteous. In Jesus' name.